Well, good afternoon. Our show today, Sunset Boulevard, concerns a silent screen star struggling to find her place in modern Hollywood. It's a clash between old and new Hollywood. It's also a love story featuring a man named Max and a fellow named Joe and a lady named Betty, all of whom orbit around a grand dame movie star named Norma Desmond. Now, our show this time takes us back to the 1950s, because the Lux Radio Theater's version of Sunset Boulevard was broadcast on September 17th, 1951. To give you some context, people in 1951 had these things on their minds. Average cost of a new house, $9,000. Cost of a gallon of gas, 19 cents. A dozen eggs, 24 cents. The average family income was $3,700 per year. The average cost of a new car, $1,500. Things have changed, huh? First oral contraceptive, the pill, was invented. The United States government began nuclear bomb testing in Nevada. The first direct-dial coast-to-coast telephone call was made. The first commercial computer, UNIVAC, was put into use by the U.S. Census Bureau. President Harry S. Truman fired General Douglas MacArthur as commander of the United Nations forces, and the 22nd Amendment was ratified, which limits the U.S. presidential term of office to 8 years or 2 terms. Now, in sports at that time, the National Football League held its first Pro Bowl. The Los Angeles Rams beat the Cleveland Browns for the NFL championship, and University of Oregon grad Norm Van Brocklin set the NFL single game record for most passing yards, 554. In baseball, Joe DiMaggio played his last game. The New York Yankees beat the Brooklyn Dodgers for the World Series. And in one of the most famous finishes in baseball history, Bobby Thompson of the New York Giants hits a 3-run walk-off home run known as the shot heard round the world. Also in pop culture at that time, Dennis the Menace comic strip appeared for the very first time. The Academy Award for Best Picture went to An American in Paris. The best actress was Vivian Leigh in A Streetcar Named Desire, and the best actor was Humphrey Bogart in The African Queen. So as we move into the fabulous 50s, we find that films were downbeat, but drive-in theaters were thriving. Some showmen called them passion pits with picks. Food, drink, and popcorn concessions yielded as much as 50% of the profit. Color TV got a foothold with fights and ball games and the like. I Love Lucy was the top TV show. Others were Sky King, Texaco Star Theater, The Red Skelton Show, Your Show of Shows, Dragnet, The Jack Benny Show, and You Bet Your Life. TV not only stole radio stars like Lucille Ball, Jack Benny, and George Burns, but it created some new stars like Sid Caesar, Imogene Coca, and Dave Garraway, plunging neckline personalities like Dagmar and Eva Gabor, grown-up quiz kids like Oscar Levant, kingpins like Ken Murray, Clifton Fadiman, Milton Berle, Arthur Godfrey, Ed Sullivan, and Ted Mack, and marionette stars like Howdy Doody and Kukla, Fran, and Ollie. On radio, this was the era of the disc jockey. The term rock and roll was coined by Cleveland disc jockey Alan Freed. It didn't matter anymore whether the record label was big or small, so relatively obscure artists arose, such as Patti Page, Red Foley, the Ames Brothers, Eileen Martin with Bake a Cake, Teresa Brewer with Music, 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 Frankie Lane with The Cry of the Wild Goose, and also hillbilly singers like Tennessee Ernie Ford, Jimmy Wakely, and Ernest Tubb. Platter music was still being played on the 78s, but they were in the midst of an LP versus 45s revolution, and thus the market was full of three-speed record changers. In the 50s, there was a vogue for original Broadway cast recordings. The hit paraders were Nat King Cole, The Weavers, and Rosemary Clooney, and among the big hits were You're Breaking My Heart, Room Full of Roses, Nature Boy, Careless Hands, That Lucky Old Sun, Don't Cry Joe, Riders in the Sky, Mule Train, and If I Knew You Were Coming, I Would Have Baked a Cake. Pop music was also mining the classics, and Perry Como put Chopin on the hit parade with Till the End of Time. Polka had its heyday. Arthur Godfrey brought back the ukulele, and a zither cycle was born with the third man theme. You remember all those? Pretty good song. Good time for pop songs. Now, all the songs our band performs are related to our story, so here's one. Backed by the Radio Redux Rhythmaires are Kirstin Parmeter and Michael Anderson to sing a song that foreshadows the events in Sunset Boulevard. Take it away.
You know, Kirstin, I got a problem with my baby.
Yeah?
Seems like every time I go over to her house, it's like she's never there. And like, I hang around for a little bit, and all of a sudden she comes like sneaking around beside me. I'm wondering what's going on.
What to make of my fella. He's always making excuses and canceling plans at the last minute. Can't figure that guy out.
Yeah. Gotta do something about this. Gotta get some resolution on this thing. What do you think?
What do you have in mind?
Well, how about this? Have a date, but I love her.
So, with that background, let's get down to business. Now, doing a show like Sunset Boulevard requires a cast, so please welcome ours. Our Foley sound effects expert is Judy Sinnott. Well, the actors are playing Police Lieutenant Thad Brown is Al Villanueva. The love-struck but clueless boyfriend, Artie, is Paul Rhoden. The tough but charming movie producer, Sheldrake, is Dan Pegoda. The lovely but clinging other woman, Betty, is Kim Donahey. The stern but devoted butler, Max, is Achilles Massahos. The desperate but nice guy, Joe Gillis, is Peter Vandegraaff. And now, sweeping onto our stage is Rebecca Nachison, who channels the spirit of that queen of the silent screen, Miss Norma Desmond. And now, on with our show.
3, 2, 1.
Lux presents Hollywood. Lever Brothers Company, the makers of Lux Toilet Soap, brings you the Lux Radio Theater in Sunset Boulevard. But first, ladies and gentlemen, your producer, Mr. Cecil B. DeMille.
Greetings from Hollywood, ladies and gentlemen. Sunset Boulevard, a busy thoroughfare in the heart of Hollywood, is far more typical of the motion picture capital than even Hollywood and Vine Streets. Here you will find the site of the first motion picture studio, the swank offices of the actors' agents, the night spots, and very far out, almost to the Pacific Ocean, the homes of the screen stars themselves. And this is where our play takes place, in the home of a famous but forgotten glamorous actress of the silent days. But we can't keep silent when it comes to Lux. No, we're shouting the fact that Lux is the favorite beauty treatment for so many Hollywood movie stars, male and female. Which is why we say, you get more from your bucks when you lather on the Lux. And now, here's Sunset Boulevard.
Twenty minutes ago, a murder was committed on Sunset Boulevard at one of those great big mansions between Hollywood and the beach. You're going to hear a lot about it because an old-time movie star is involved, one of the biggest. The police haven't arrived yet, but they're on their way, I guess. The victim's body is still floating in the swimming pool. Nobody important, really, just a movie writer with a couple of B pictures to his credit. A poor dope. He always wanted a swimming pool. Well, he got the pool. Only the price turned out to be a little high. Let's go back about 6 months and find the day when it all started. Things had been pretty tough. I hadn't sold a story in months, but I knew a big shot over at Paramount who always seemed to have liked me, and the time had come to take advantage of it. He was a smart producer with a set of ulcers to prove it.
All right, Gillis, you got 5 minutes. What's your story about?
Well, it's about a baseball player, Mr. Sheldrake. Mm-hmm. The poor kid was once mixed up in a holdup, but he's trying to go straight. I submitted an outline a while back. I imagine your story department's got a report on it.
Baseball story, huh?
Yeah, with a real good gimmick at the end.
You got a title?
Bases Loaded, huh? And you got exactly the man for it right here on the lot, Alan Ladd. Be a great change of pace for him.
Come in.
Hello, Mr. Sheldrake.
Hello.
That Bases Loaded script covered it with a 2-page synopsis.
Oh, thank you.
I wouldn't bother.
Oh, what's wrong with it?
It's from hunger.
Well, I'm sure you'll be very glad to meet Mr. Gillis. He wrote it. This is Miss Schaefer from the reading department.
And right now, I wish I could crawl into a hole and pull it in after me.
If I could be of any help, Miss Schaefer.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Gillis. I just didn't think it was any good.
Just what kind of material do you recommend? James Joyce? Dostoevsky?
Perhaps the reason I hated Bases Loaded is that I knew your name. I'd always heard that you had some talent.
Yeah, that was last year. This year I'm trying to pay the rent.
That'll be all, Miss Schaefer. Thank you very much.
Goodbye, Mr. Gillis.
Look, I don't want you to think I thought this was going to win any Academy Award, but I'm over a barrel, Mr. Sheldrake. I need a job.
I haven't got a thing.
Any kind of assignment. Additional dialogue, rewrite.
There's nothing honest.
Mr. Sheldrake, well, could you let me have $300? It's for my car. They're after my car. I mean yourself, as a personal loan.
Could I? Gillis, last year somebody talked me into buying a ranch in the valley, so I borrowed the money from the bank to pay for the ranch. This year, I had to mortgage the ranch so I could keep up my life insurance, so I could borrow my insurance, so I could pay back the bank. And then there's a little matter called income tax. Now,
well, that was that. I drove out of the parking lot, no place in particular, just driving and trying to think things out. The time had come to wrap up the whole Hollywood deal and somehow get back to Ohio. I stopped for a traffic light, and behind me in the mirror, I saw a very familiar car. Two gentlemen from the Friendly Finance Company. I jumped the light and stepped on the gas. I was on Sunset Boulevard now, heading toward the beach. Suddenly, a tire blew out. There wasn't time to think twice. I turned off the road into a private driveway. I ducked behind some fancy shrubbery and waited. I was safe. The house was a great big white elephant of a place, the kind crazy movie people built in the crazy 20s. A neglected house gets an unhappy look. Well, this one had it in spades, dismal and damp-looking, all grown over with some devouring sort of ivy. I started wondering how anyone could ever...
You there! Why are you so late?
Well, I beg your pardon, but I...
In just... here! Come in!
Well, I just left my car in the driveway. I had a blowout. I thought maybe I
Go
could just...
Go inside.
Have him come up, Max.
Wipe your feet. Go on. You're not properly dressed for the occasion.
What occasion?
Go up the stairs.
Now, suppose you listen to me for a minute.
Madame is waiting.
For me? Okay.
If you need any help, call me.
So, I went up the staircase. It led to a huge bedroom, and on a table, covered with a Spanish shawl, was a monkey. A dead monkey. I guess I just stood there staring.
You should have been here hours ago. I put him there because he always liked to be near the fire. Well, I've made up my mind that he'd be buried in the garden. Any city laws against that?
I wouldn't know.
Oh, I don't care anyway. I want the coffin to be white. I want it specially lined with satin. White, or maybe deep pink. Now, I warn you, don't quote me a fancy price just because I'm rich.
Look, you've got the wrong man, lady. I had some trouble with my car. I thought the place was empty.
It is not. Get out.
I'm sorry. Hey. Excuse me, but haven't I seen you before?
Get out!
You're Norma Desmond. You used to be in silent pictures. You used to be big.
I am big. It's the pictures that got small.
Yeah, I knew there was something wrong with them.
They're dead. They're finished. There was a time when they had the eyes of the whole wide world, but that wasn't good enough for them. Oh no. They had to have the ears of the world, too. So they opened their big mouths, and out came talk.
Yeah, well, that's where the popcorn business comes in. You buy yourself a bag, you plug up your ears.
Look at them in the front offices, the masterminds. They took the idols and smashed them, the Fairbankses, the Gilberts, the Valentinos. And who have you got now? Some nobodies.
Well, don't blame me. I'm not a producer, just a writer.
You are? Writing words, more words. Well, you've made a rope of words and strangled this business.
Shh, you'll wake up the monkey.
Get out! Max?
Okay, I'm going.
Just a minute, you. A writer, you said.
Well?
Are you or aren't you?
Oh, sure. The last story I sold was about Okies in the Dust Bowl. But you'd never know, because when it reached the screen, the whole thing played on a torpedo boat.
I happen to have written a script myself. It's the story of Salome. I think I'll have DeMille direct it.
And you'll play Salome?
Who else?
I'm only asking. I didn't know you were planning a comeback.
Oh, I hate that word. It's a return. A return to the millions of people who have never forgiven me for deserting the screen.
Fair enough.
Salome, what a woman, what a part. The princess in love with a holy man. He rejects her, so she demands his head on a golden tray, kissing his cold, dead lips.
Oh, they'll love it in Pomona.
They'll love it every place. Read it. Read my manuscript. Read the scene just before she has him killed.
Now look, never let another writer read your material, Miss Desmond. He may steal it.
Oh, I'm not afraid. Max!
Yes, madame?
The young man is staying for a while. Get some champagne.
So I started to read. Sometimes it's interesting to see just how bad writing can be. Well, this promised to go the limit. She sat in front of me, coiled up like a watch spring, defying me not to like what I read, or maybe begging me in her own proud way to like it. It meant so much to her. It sure was a cozy setup, that bundle of raw nerves and Max and the dead monkey. Later on, just for comedy relief, the real guy arrived with a little coffin. It was all done with great dignity. He must have been a very important chimp. Well, it got to be evening. I was feeling a little sick to my stomach, what with the champagne and that tripe I'd been reading. By then, however, I'd started making up a little plot of my own.
Well, you're not going to stop reading.
This is fascinating.
Of course it is.
All it needs is maybe a little more dialogue.
Oh, what for? I can say anything I want with my eyes.
Well, it certainly could use a little editing.
I will not have it butchered.
Oh, of course not. Just a touch here and there. You can find somebody.
Who? I'd have to have somebody I could trust. When were you born? I mean, what sign of the zodiac?
I don't know.
What month? What date?
Oh, December. December 21st.
Sagittarius. I like Sagittarians. You can trust them.
Thank you.
I want you to do this work.
Me? Oh, no, I'm busy. I've got a job.
Well, I don't care.
And I'm pretty expensive. I get $500 a week.
Oh, I wouldn't worry about money. I'll make it worth your while.
Well, maybe I'd better take it home and look it over there.
Oh, no, I won't let it out of my house. You will have to work here.
Well, it's getting kind of late.
Are you married, mister?
The name is Gillis, single.
Where do you live?
Hollywood, Alto Nido Apartments.
There's something wrong with your car, you said.
There sure is.
Why shouldn't you stay here?
Look, I'll come back tomorrow.
Oh, nonsense. There's a room over the garage. Max will take you there. Max, come here.
I felt kind of pleased with the way I'd handled that situation. Sure, I'd work on her script. Meanwhile, my car would be safe, and the money prospects look very good indeed.
This garage room has not been used for a long time.
Well, I guess it's okay for one night. She is quite a character, isn't she?
She was the greatest of them all. You wouldn't know, you're too young. In 1 week, she received 17,000 fan letters.
Yeah, I sure turned into an interesting driveway.
You did, sir. Good night, Mr. Gillis.
I pegged him as slightly cuckoo, too, a stroke, maybe. Come to think of it, the whole place seemed to have been stricken with a kind of creeping paralysis, out of beat with the rest of the world, crumbling apart in slow motion. When I woke up the next morning, all my belongings were there, suitcases, books, even my typewriter. Well, I threw on some clothes and ran over to the house.
Of course, your things are there. I brought them myself.
Is that so? Well, who said you could? Who asked you to?
I did. It seemed like a good idea if we are to work together.
Well, there's nothing in the deal that says anything about my staying here.
Oh, you'll like it here. Besides, you can't work in an apartment where you owe 3 months' rent.
I'll take care of that.
It's all taken care of. Max, unpack Mr. Gillis's things.
It has been done, madame.
Well, pack him up again. I didn't say I was staying.
Well, then suppose you make up your mind. Do you want this job or not?
Yes, I wanted the job. I wanted the dough. But it wasn't so simple getting some coherence into those wild hallucinations she called a script. And what made it even tougher was that she was around all the time, hovering over me, afraid I'd do some injury to that precious brainchild of hers.
But what are those papers on the floor?
That's just a scene I threw out.
What scene?
Well, the one where you go to the slave market. It's better to cut directly to John the Baptist.
Cut away from me?
Well, honestly, they don't want to see you in every scene.
Don't they? Then why do they write me fan letters every day? Why do they beg me for my photographs? Why? Because they want to see me. Me, Norma Desmond.
Okay, okay.
You'll put those pages back there where they belong.
So I put them back. You don't yell at a sleepwalker. He may fall and break his neck. You know, that was it. She was still sleepwalking along the giddy heights of a lost career, playing crazy when it came to that one subject, her celluloid self, the great Norma Desmond. It wasn't all work, of course. Sometimes there'd be little bridge games at the house, friends of hers, actors. Dim figures you might still remember from silent pictures. I think of them as her waxworks, fragile and old. They'd come and they'd go quietly like ghosts. They never spoke to me. I don't believe they even asked her who I was. On other nights, Max would operate a motion picture machine. We'd see a movie right in her living room, a silent movie. I guess I don't have to tell you who the star was. They were always her pictures. That's all she wanted to see.
Oh, still wonderful, isn't it? And no dialogue. We didn't need dialogue. We had faces. Oh, those idiot producers, those imbeciles. Haven't they got any eyes? Have they forgotten what a star looks like? I'll show them. I'll be up there again, so help me.
One morning, Max came in with bad news for me. The men from the finance company had paid us a visit, and they'd found my car, and they'd towed it away.
Oh, don't be ridiculous, Joe. They took your car. It's not a matter of life and death.
Well, it is to me. That's why I took this job.
Oh, now you're being silly. We don't need two cars. We have a car. And not one of those cheap new things made of chromium and spit. An Isotta Fraschini. Have you ever heard of an Isotta Fraschini? All handmade. Cost me $28,000.
So, Max got the old bus down off its blocks and polished it up again. It was upholstered in leopard skin and had one of those car phones gold-plated.
Oh, that's a dreadful shirt you're wearing, Joe.
Yeah? What's wrong with it?
Oh, nothing, if you work in a filling station. And I'm getting rather bored with that same sport jacket and the same baggy pants. Max?
Yes, madame?
Take us to a good men's shop in town. The very best. Take us there now.
Yes, madame.
I don't need any clothes. I certainly don't want you buying them for me.
Why begrudge me a little fun? I just want you to look nice. And, must you chew gum?
The last week in December, the rains came. Came right through the old roof of my room over the garage. So she had Max move me into the main house. I didn't much like the idea, but it's better than sleeping in a raincoat and galoshes.
You should be quite comfortable here, Mr. Gillis.
Mm-hmm. Whose room was this?
It was the room of the husband. Or the husbands, I should say. Madame has been married 3 times.
Mm. Hey, what's the matter with the door? There isn't any lock.
There are no locks anywhere in this house, sir.
How come?
Madame has had some moments of melancholy. There have been some attempts at suicide.
Oh.
We have to be very careful. No sleeping pills, no razor blades. We turn off the gas in Madame's bedroom.
Why? Her career? She got enough out of it. She's not forgotten. She still gets those fan letters.
Those letters? I would not look too closely at the postmarks.
You send them. Is that it, Max?
I better press your evening clothes, sir. Mr. Gillis has not forgotten Madame's New Year's Eve party.
A party? What party? Has Joe forgotten about it? And why should he attend? We'll find out the answers after a 20-minute intermission. You are listening to the Lux Radio Theater's adaptation of Sunset Boulevard. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Well, welcome back to the Lux Radio Theater Sunset Boulevard. But before we resume our story, let's set the scene between Joe and Norma with this musical number by the Radio Redux Rhythmaires featuring Kirstin Parmeter.
One, two, three, four.
Joe, you know Norma wants you.
Make up your mind to have no regrets. Resign yourself, recline yourself, you're through. I always get what I aim for, and your heart and soul is what I came for. Whatever Norma wants, Norma gets. Take off your coat, don't you know you can win? You're no exception to the rule. I'm irresistible, you fool. Give in.
And now here is Act Two of Sunset Boulevard. Down on his luck, screenwriter Joe Gillis considered himself one lucky guy when he chanced upon the home of silent screen star Norma Desmond. But she has strange things in mind for him. One of them is a New Year's Eve party that she believes he has forgotten about.
No, I hadn't forgotten the party. I dreaded it. But I was curious as to who would be there. I heard voices, Max ushering in the orchestra. A little later on, they started to play. This was the night I was to find out how she felt about me. I'd been an idiot not to have sensed it coming, that sad, embarrassing revelation. She was dancing alone, a tango. And then she saw me and came over to the foot of the stairs. If there had been any hope of ducking that New Year's Eve party, believe me, I would not have been there. As it was, I had put on that dinner jacket from the best shop in town and went downstairs.
Oh, Joe, you look absolutely divine. Turn around.
Oh, please.
Oh, come on. Perfect, wonderful shoulders. And I love that line.
Oh, it's all padding. Don't let it fool you.
Cute. You know, this floor used to be wood, but I had it changed. Valentino said there's nothing like tile for a tango. You tango, don't you?
Not on the same floor with Valentino. Norma, it's late. What time are you supposed to get here?
Who?
The other guests.
There are no other guests. This is for you and me, Joe.
Oh?
Hold me tighter.
Okay.
You think this is all very funny?
A little.
Be patient, Joe. You'll think it's nice, not funny. You'll think it's very nice.
So we danced, Norma Desmond and I, in a room big enough for a softball game, to the music of a 20-piece orchestra.
Oh, what a wonderful year it's going to be, Joe. What fun we'll have. I'll fill my pool for you, or I'll open my house in Malibu, and you can have the whole ocean. And when our picture's finished, I'll buy you a boat, and we'll sail to Honolulu.
Stop it. You're not going to buy me anything anymore.
Oh, don't be silly. I'm rich, Joe. I'm richer than all this new Hollywood trash. I've got $1 million.
Keep it.
I own 3 blocks downtown. I've got oil in Bakersfield. Pumping, pumping, pumping. What's it for but to buy us anything we want?
Cut out that us business.
What's the matter with you?
Has it ever occurred to you that I may have a life of my own? That there may be some girl I'm crazy about?
Oh, some car hop? Some dress extra from Central Casting?
What I'm trying to tell you is that I'm all wrong for you. You want a Valentino, somebody with polo ponies, a big shot.
What you're trying to say is you don't want me to love you, is that it? Well, say it. Say it. Say it.
She left the room and rushed upstairs, and the orchestra kept playing. Well, I'd had enough. I grabbed my coat and I left. I thought about a friend of mine, Artie Green, an assistant director. There was bound to be a New Year's shindig going on in his apartment. I walked down to the Boulevard and hitched a ride into town.
Wow, what do you know? Joe Gillis.
Hey, Artie.
Hey, where have you been? I dropped by your place a couple weeks ago. The landlady
yeah,
said
well,
that you...
Yeah, well, I moved out. To a deep freeze. Oh. Look, I'll give you a full report later. Meantime, could I stick around here for a while?
Oh, this is going to go on all night.
No, I mean, could you put me up for a week or so?
Well, sure, Joe, sure. Just stand by, kid. I'm going to get you a drink.
Hello, Mr. Gillis.
Oh, hello.
Betty Schaefer. Do you remember? Sheldrake's office.
Oh, yes.
Oh, I've been hoping I'd run into you, Mr. Gillis.
What for? To recover that knife you stuck in my back?
Oh, well, I did feel a little guilty, so I got out some of your old stories.
Why, you sweet kid.
Oh, please. Oh, I'd love to talk to you. Hey, come on. Let's go into the other room.
I didn't pay much attention to what Betty was trying to tell me. Too much noise, too many people having a good time. But suddenly, I knew I was feeling good again. And that she was part of that feeling. I told her to wait for me. I'd be right back. I had a phone call to make.
I'm sorry, Mr. Gillis, but I cannot talk to you now.
Yes, you can. Now look, Max, I want you to get up my old suitcase and pack up all my old...
I have no time to do anything now. The doctor is here.
Doctor? What's going on?
Madame got the razor from your room, and she cut her wrist.
Max? Max? Hello, Max!
Hey, Joe, where you going? Joe, what did you do to him, honey? Did you scare him or something?
Who was he talking to, Artie? Why would he leave like that?
I don't know. Gosh, how do you like that guy?
Thank you for coming back, Mr. Gillis.
How is she?
The doctor says she will be all right. Be careful, Mr. Gillis. Be careful what you say to her.
Norma?
Oh, go away. Don't look at me. Go away and let me alone.
What kind of a silly thing was that to do?
To fall in love with you? That was the idiotic thing.
Sure would have made attractive headlines. Great star kills herself for unknown writer.
Great stars have great pride. Go away. Go back to that girl of yours.
Look, I was making that up because I thought the whole thing was a mistake. I didn't want to hurt you. You've been good to me, Norma. You're the only person in this stinking town who's been good to me.
Then why don't you just say thank you and get out?
Not until you promise to act like a sensible human being.
I'll do it again. I'll do it again. I'll do it again.
Norma, happy New Year, Norma.
Oh, Joe. Happy New Year, darling.
the following day, if it hadn't been for her bandaged wrists, no one would have dreamed that here was a woman who tried to kill herself.
Immediately, Max. Take this script over to Paramount, and be sure you deliver it to Mr. DeMille in person.
Very good, madame.
You're really going to send it to DeMille?
Well, this is the day. This is the day, Joe. Look, here's the chart from my astrologer. She's read DeMille's horoscope. She's read mine.
Did she read the script? Norma, scripts don't sell on astrologers' charts.
Oh, but darling, I'm not just selling the script, I'm selling me. DeMille always said I was his greatest star.
When did he say it, Norma?
Well, all right, it was quite a few years ago, but the point is I never looked better in my life. And do you know why? Because I've never been as happy in my life. Well, now hurry, Max, hurry.
It's for you, madame. The telephone. Paramount is calling.
Now, do you believe me, Joe? Paramount is calling. I told you DeMille would jump at my story.
It's not Mr. DeMille in person, madame. Someone by the name of Gordon Cole. He says it is very important.
Well, certainly it's important. The very idea of having some assistant call me. Say that I'm busy and hang up.
Very good, madame.
How do you like that? We've made 12 pictures together, his greatest successes.
Maybe he's busy. Maybe he's shooting.
Oh, I know that trick. He's trying to belittle me. He's trying to get my price down. Well, I've waited 20 years for this call. Now DeMille can wait until I'm good and ready.
About 3 days later, she was good and ready. Incredible as it may seem, there had been more of those urgent calls from Paramount. So she put on a half pound of makeup and fixed it up with a veil and set forth to see DeMille in person.
Joe, are you sure you don't want to see Mr. DeMille with me, dear?
No, I'll wait outside. It's your script, Norma. It's your show. Good luck.
Oh, thank you, darling. Max, what are we waiting for?
The gate, madame.
Hey, hold that noise, will you please?
We're here to see Mr. DeMille. Open the gate.
Mr. DeMille is shooting. Have you got an appointment?
No appointment necessary. I'm bringing Norma Desmond.
Norma who?
Norma Desmond.
Oh, Jonesy. It is you, Jonesy.
Why, Miss Desmond. Oh, how have you been, Miss Desmond?
Just tell that officer to open the gate.
Sure, Miss Desmond, sure. Okay, Mac, open it up.
Well, they can't drive on the lot without a pass.
Miss Desmond can. Open it up.
Where's Mr. DeMille shooting, Jonesy?
Stage 18, Miss Desmond.
Well, thank you, Jonesy. And teach your young friend some manners. Tell him without me he wouldn't have any job. Because without me, there wouldn't be any Paramount Studio. Max, stage 18.
It wasn't possible. How could a man of DeMille's intelligence see even a glimmer of hope in a script as bad as the one she'd set him? But he came out of the soundstage and put his arms around her and then led her into his set.
You saw them, Mr. Gillis. The extras, the electricians, they fall all over each other just to get a look at her. You see that row of officers? That used to be Madame's dressing room. The whole row.
It didn't leave much for Wallace Reed. Oh, that sign over there, Max. Reader's department. Reminds me, I want to look somebody up. I'll be back in a few minutes.
Well, for heaven's sake, come on in. Oh, have a chair.
Hello, Betty. I just thought I'd tell you, if you still think there's anything in that story of mine, go ahead and take it. It's all yours.
Why?
Well, it's no good to me. Help yourself. I mean it.
But that doesn't make sense. Besides, I'm just not good enough to do it by myself.
Well, what about all those ideas you have?
Oh, you don't even know what they are. Maybe they aren't any good. Oh, Joe, please. Now, if you're busy, maybe we could work evenings or even 6 o'clock in the morning.
Artie would just love that.
Well, for the next month, Artie won't mind at all. He's out of town. Incidentally, we're engaged.
Oh? Huh. Well, good for you. You couldn't find a nicer guy.
Well, that's what I think. Anyway, he's on location in Arizona, so I'm free every evening and every weekend.
Look, Betty, it can't be done. It's out. Now, stop being chicken-hearted and write that story. Don't make it too dreary. Get a few laughs in it. So long, Betty. Good luck.
Oh, honest to goodness, I hate you.
As I walked back to the car, I saw someone talking to Max. He was just leaving. Then Max turned to me and looked at me helplessly. What's the matter?
That man, one of DeMille's assistants.
Well?
The reason for all those telephone calls to the madame. It was not DeMille. It was the property department who called.
Property department?
The car. They saw the car when I brought the script here. They want to rent the car for a Bing Crosby picture.
And DeMille's going to tell her then?
He will know what to tell her. He remembers her. He will not break her heart.
Hey, take it easy. She's coming.
You see? Look at her. Look at her. She's radiant.
Well, how did it go?
Oh, it couldn't have gone better. It's practically set. Of course, he has to finish this picture first. It's a circus picture. But I'm next. I'm sure I'm next. Oh, he said nothing would please him more than to work with me again.
Norma.
Oh, it's nothing. I just didn't realize what it would be like to come back to the old studio. Well, what are you waiting for, Max?
Forgive me, madame. Your arm, madame?
After that, an army of beauty experts invaded the house. She went through a merciless series of treatments, like an athlete training for the Olympic Games. She went to bed every night at 9. She was absolutely determined to be ready. Ready for those cameras that would never turn.
Joe, darling, are you there?
Yes, Norma.
Oh, don't turn around. Keep your eyes on the book. I just came down to say goodnight. I don't want you to see me. I'm not very attractive at the moment.
All right, good night.
You know, I've lost a pound and a half since Tuesday.
Good.
You going to read all night?
For a while.
You went out last night, didn't you, Joe?
I went for a walk.
Oh, no, you didn't. You took the car. No, it's all right. It's just that I don't want to be left alone. Not while I'm under this terrible strain. All I ask is for you to be a little patient and a little kind.
Norma, I have not done anything.
Oh, of course you haven't. I wouldn't let you. Good night, darling.
Yes, she was right. I was playing hooky every night. That story of mine that Betty Schaefer had dug up kept going through my head like a locomotive. I had phoned her, and we'd started working on it, just the two of us, in her office, nights, when the studio was deserted. And sometimes when we got stuck, we'd walk around the lot, just wandering down alleys between the sound stages or through the sets they were getting ready for the next day's shooting. It was on one of those walks that Betty first told me about her nose.
And so, naturally, my family expected me to become a great star. Anyway, the studio made a test, but they didn't like my nose. They said it slanted a little.
Ah, they're crazy.
Oh, no, they're not. So I went to a doctor and had it fixed. Then they gave me another test. This time they were crazy about my nose, but they didn't like my acting.
That is the saddest thing I have ever heard.
Not at all. You know, it really taught me a little sense. So I got a job in the mailroom, then stenographic, and now I'm a reader.
Three cheers for Betty Schaefer. And I will now kiss her nose. Oh,
if you please.
May I say that you smell real special?
Must be my new shampoo.
No, that's not shampoo. It's more like freshly laundered linen handkerchiefs. Mm. And may I suggest that if we're ever to finish our story, you stay at least 2 feet away from me at all times. Now let's walk back to your office. It was long past midnight when I got back to the house. Max was waiting for me on the patio.
Mr. Gillis, you must be very careful. Madame may be watching. Mr. Gillis, I'm not inquiring where you go every night.
Well, why don't you? I'm writing a script. I'm going to finish it.
It is just that I am greatly worried about Madame.
You're not helping her any, feeding her those lies and more lies. What happens when she finds out there isn't going to be any picture?
She will never find out. That's my job. It's been my job for a long time. I made Norma Desmond a star, and I cannot let her be destroyed.
You made her a star?
I discovered her. I directed all her early films.
And she's turned you into a servant.
It was I who asked to come back. Humiliating as that may seem, you see, I was her first husband.
The following night, as usual, I was in Betty's office. Betty was strangely quiet. It wasn't like her. Something had happened.
I'm sorry, Joe. I don't want to talk about it.
Oh, is it about me? What have you heard?
No, it's Artie. He sent me a telegram.
Oh, anything wrong?
He wants me to come on to Arizona, Joe. He said it only cost $2 to get married there.
Well, why don't you? Well, stop crying, will you? You're getting married. That's what you wanted.
I don't want it now.
Why not? Don't you love Artie?
Oh, of course I love him. I always will. I'm not in love with him anymore, that's all.
What happened?
You did. Oh, Joe. Oh, Joe.
She'd been a fool not to sense there was something phony in my setup, and I'd been a heel not to have told her, but you just can't say those things to somebody you're crazy about. Maybe I'd never have to. Maybe I could get away with it. Get away from Norma. Maybe I could wipe the whole nasty mess right out of my life. As soon as I got back to that peculiar prison of mine, I went to Norma's room. The door was closed, but I could hear her talking on the telephone.
Oh, forgive me for calling you so late, Miss Schaefer, but I really feel it's my duty. Oh, never mind who I am. You do know Mr. Gillis. Exactly how much do you know about him? Do you know where he lives? Do you know how he lives? Oh, Miss Schaefer, I'm trying to spare you a great deal of misery. Oh, very well, then ask him. Ask him.
Give me that phone.
Oh, no, Joe,
give it to me. That's right, Betty, ask me. Or better yet, why don't you come out and see for yourself? The address is 10,086 Sunset Boulevard.
Oh, don't hate me, Joe, don't hate me. I found a script in your room. Your name was on it, your name and hers. I called her up because I need you. I need you as I've never needed you before. Oh, look at me. Look at my hands, look at my face, look under my eyes. How can I go back to work if I'm wasting away under this torment? You don't know what I've been through these last weeks. I bought myself a revolver. I did. I stood in front of that mirror, but I couldn't make myself do it. Don't just stand there hating me. Shout at me. Strike me, but don't hate me. Oh, don't, Joe. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? What are you going to do?
What was I going to do? Over and over, she kept repeating those words, sobbing, hysterical. I left the room and went out of doors. I kept walking around. And then I saw some headlights and a car turned into the driveway. Betty had come.
Joe, what is it? What's wrong? I didn't know what to do, so I jumped in the car.
Come on in. Come on in the house, Betty.
I don't know. I don't know why I'm scared, Joe. Is it something awful?
Take a look around, Betty. Ever been in one of these old Hollywood palazzos? They built them like this, and they were making $18,000 a week and no taxes.
You live here, Joe?
You bet.
Whose house is it?
Whose? Well, there are 100 photographs of her in that one room. If you don't remember the face, you must have heard the name, Norma Desmond.
Why did she call me?
Did you ever see so much junk? She had the ceiling brought all the way over from Portugal. Look at this.
Joe, what about Norma Desmond?
That's what I'm trying to tell you. This is an enormous place. It's lonely here. So she got herself a companion. Very simple setup. An older woman who's well-to-do, a younger man who's not doing too well. Can you figure it out yourself?
No.
All right, I'll give you a few more clues.
No, I haven't heard any of this. She never called me, and I've never been in this house. Now get your things together, and let's get out of here.
All my things? My 18 suits, my custom-made shoes, the 6 dozen shirts, the cufflinks, platinum keychains, cigarette cases.
Come on, Joe.
Come on where? Back to a one-room apartment I can't pay the rent for? Back to a story that may sell and very possibly may not?
If you love me, Joe.
Look, sweetie, be practical. I like it here. Maybe it's not very admirable. Well, you and Artie, you can be admirable.
I can't look at you anymore,
well,
Joe.
Well, how about looking for the exit, then? This way. Good luck to you, Betty. You can finish that script on your way to Prescott, Arizona. And when you and Artie get back, if the two of you ever feel like taking a swim, there's a pool out there. Italian marble, soft-colored lights.
Oh, Thank you, darling. Thank you, Joe.
Get out of my way. I'm leaving, Norma.
Joe, no. You can't leave me. You can't.
I said I'm leaving.
No, you're not.
Thanks for letting me wear the handsome wardrobe. Thanks for the use of all the trinkets. The jewelry's all in the top drawer.
No, it's yours, Joe. I gave it to
and
you.
And I take it in a second, only it's a little too dressy for Dayton, Ohio.
What I gave you was nothing. You can have anything you want. What is it you want? Money?
You'd be throwing it away, Norma. I don't qualify for the job. Not anymore.
You can't go. Max! I can't face life without you. And you know I'm not afraid to die.
That's between you and yourself.
All right, see? I do have a gun. I suppose you don't think I have the courage.
Oh, sure, if it would make a good scene.
You don't care, do you? Well, hundreds of thousands of people will care.
Oh, wake up, Norma. You'd be killing yourself to an empty house. The audience left 20 years ago. Now face it.
That's a lie. They still want me.
No, they don't.
What about the studio? What about DeMille?
He couldn't hurt you. He couldn't hurt anyone. DeMille was trying to spare your feelings. The studio only wanted to rent your car.
Wanted what?
DeMille didn't have the heart to tell you. None of us had the heart. Come on in, Max. Go on, tell her.
It's a lie. They want me. I get letters every day.
Do her that favor, Max. Tell her there isn't going to be any picture. There aren't any fan letters, except the ones that you write.
Max, that isn't true.
Madame is still the greatest star of them all. I'll take Mr. Gillis's things to the car.
You heard him. I'm a star.
Norma, you're a woman of 50. Now grow up. There's nothing tragic about being 50. Not unless you try to be 25.
I'm the greatest star of them all.
Goodbye, Norma.
No one ever leaves a star. That's what makes one a star.
I left her standing there. I grabbed my coat and started out. She kept calling.
Joe!
I could hear her running after me.
Joe!
I was out of the house now. The air suddenly felt fresh again, clean. I started across the patio. She called me once again.
Joe!
But I didn't stop. I kept on going. Suddenly, it was with great effort I kept on walking. I was alongside the pool now. If I could only... This is just about where you came in, back at that pool again. The one I always wanted. Only now the place is crawling with people. The police, detectives, reporters, photographers. They took pictures of me in the pool, then they took pictures of me out of the pool. They were very careful with me, gentle. It's funny how gentle people get with you once you're dead. Well, the newsreel guys are roaring in now. Here's an item everyone can have some fun with. Heartless so-and-sos. What would they do to Norma? Even if she gets away with it in court, crime of passion, temporary insanity, the headlines are going to kill her. Forgotten star, slayer, aging actress, yesterday's glamour queen. They found her upstairs, sitting at her dressing table, arranging her hair.
She just won't talk, Captain. State of shock, I guess.
Miss Desmond, please, you don't deny having killed that man?
Just answer us, yes or no. Did you intend to kill him?
Who is he? Where did you first meet him? Where does he come from?
Newsreel men are here with their cameras, Captain.
Tell them to go fly a kite. It's no time for cameras. Miss Desmond, is there anything else you want to tell us?
Cameras? He said cameras. What is it, Max?
The cameras have arrived, Madame.
They have? Tell Mr. DeMille I'll be on the set at once.
What is this?
It's one way to get her downstairs, isn't it?
Okay, we'll have the car right outside.
Everything would be ready, madame.
Oh, thank you, Max. You'll pardon me, gentlemen, but I must get ready for my scene.
The cameramen were at the foot of the stairs, dozen reporters firing questions, but Max didn't even bother to look at them. It was the cameras he was interested in.
Quiet, everybody! Miss Desmond is coming. Lights, turn up the lights. Are you ready, Norma?
What is the scene? Where am I?
This is the staircase of the palace.
Oh, yes.
Down below, they are waiting for the princess.
I'm ready, Max.
All right. Camera, action!
So they were turning after all. Those cameras. Life, which can be strangely merciful, had taken pity on Norma Desmond. She came down the stairs. They were not policemen, they were not photographers or reporters or just the morbidly curious. To Norma, they were her public, her fans. And she was back again, working with DeMille.
Oh, I can't go on with the scene. I'm too happy. Oh, Mr. DeMille, do you mind if I say a few words? Thank you. I just want to tell all of you how happy I am to be back in the studio making a picture again. You don't know how much I've missed all of you. And I promise you, I'll never desert you again. Because after Salome, we'll make another picture and another picture. You see, this is my life. It always will be. There's nothing else. Just us and the cameras and those wonderful people out there in the dark. All right, Mr. DeMille. I'm ready for my close-up.